Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. We
Assalamualaikum.
are from seven topic group. Here we are going to present our topic, which is linguistic varieties and multilingual nations in EFL context. Next. Here our group member. Myself, Robi Deta Sumarlin.
And me, Ardi Surya Saputra.
Here are our table of content. We're going to talk about vernacular language, standard language, world Englishes, lingua francas, pidgins and crolles, and origins and endings. Sociolinguistics have developed a number of ways of categorizing languages according to their status and social functions. The distinction between a vernacular language and a standard language is a useful place to start. Vernacular language, it generally refers to language which has not been standardized and which does not have official status. There are hundreds of vernacular languages such as Buang in Papua New Guinea, Hindustani in India, and Bumbar in Vanuatu, many of which have never been written down or described. In a multilingual speech community, the many different ethnic or tribal languages used by different groups are referred to as vernacular languages. Vernaculars are usually the first languages learned by people in multilingual communities, and they are often used for a relatively narrow range of informal functions. There are three components of the meaning of the term vernacular. First, the most basic refers to the fact that a vernacular is an uncodified or unstandardized variety. The second refers to the way it is acquired in the home as a first variety. The third is the fact that it is used for relatively circumscribed functions. The first component has been most widely used as the defining criterion, but emphasis on one of other of the component has led to the use of the term vernacular with somewhat different meanings. The term vernacular is also sometimes used to indicate that a language is used for everyday interaction without implying that it is appropriate only in informal domains. Next. This is standard language. A standard variety is generally one which is written and which has undergone some degree of regulation or codification. For example, in grammar or in a dictionary. It is recognized as a prestigious variety or code by a community, and it is used for each function alongside a diversity of L varieties. There is a very general definition, and it immediately excludes most of the world's 4 or 5,000 languages. Only a minority of the world's languages are written, and even smaller minority are standardized in the sense of codified and accepted by the community as suitable for formal functions. The development of standard English illustrates the three essential criteria which characterize a standard. First, it was an influential or prestigious variety. Second, it was codified and stabilized. And the last is it served its function in that it was used for communication at court, for literature, and for administration. Next. This is world English. The term world English and new English has been used to emphasize the range of different varieties of English that have developed since the 19th century. The local varieties of English which have developed in New Zealand, Australia, Canada, and the USA, where most of the population are monolingual English speakers, are examples of inner circle English varieties. Kachuru also identified an expanding circle of those who were learning English as an additional adjunct or foreign language over a wide range of reasons, such as trade or access to higher education. As in China or Japan, English is a foreign language in the expanding circle, serving no crucial communication function within a country. However, globalization means there are now many more speakers of English in the outer and expanding circle than in the inner circle. And with English as the global language of the internet and computer mediated communication, it seems likely that variation in old and new English, both written and spoken, is likely to continue to develop. Next. Language Francas. English has clearly served as a language as of wider communication in many pluralistic contexts. And in many multilingual countries, alternatively, a particular vernacular or local languages may develop the role of a language of wider communication in a multilingual area, such as languages are labeled as lingua francas. Lingua franca is a language used for communication between people whose first languages differ. More generally, however, the term lingua franca describes a language serving as a regular means of communication between different linguistic groups in a multilingual speech community. In some countries, the most useful and widely used lingua franca is an official language or the national language. In Tanzania, for instance, Swahili is the language people tend to choose first when they are speaking to someone from different tribal groups. In multilingual community, lingua francas are so useful they may eventually displace the vernaculars. When people from different ethnic groups marry in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Zaire, or Tanzania, or Papua New Guinea, they often use the lingua franca of their area as the language of the home. And their children may therefore learn very little of their fathers and mothers' vernaculars. Maintaining linguistic distinctiveness is important in this multilingual community. If linguistic distinctiveness is an important identifying value for a group, then ethnic languages and vernaculars tend to survive, often for a considerably time. Lingua franca often develop initially as trade languages, illustrating again the influence of economic factors on language change. Next material will be presented by RD.
Okay, thank you, Robby. So now I will explain about pidgins. Okay, what is pidgin? Pidgin is a language which has no native speakers. Pidgin has developed as a means of communication between people who do not have a common language. So pidgin is no one native language. And so pidgin is a variety of language created by community, a group of people who do not have common language to communicate. So for communication, they create the variety which is called pidgins. Pidgin characteristic, usually it used as a colonialism, threat language, small vocabulary, and attitude. For colonialism, for example, on Caribbean slave plantation in 7th and 18th centuries, West African people were deliberately separate from other who use the same language. So to reduce the risk of their plotting to escape or rebel, the colonial need to communicate with local. So for this purpose, they develop pidgins. For threat language, it is used on seacoast in multilingual context. Pidgin developed as a language of trade between the traders who use a colonial language such as Portuguese, Spanish, or English, and also Indian, Chinese, African, or American that they were trading with. In many fact, many of the meaning which has been suggested for the word pidgin reflect its use as a means of communication between traders. But not all pidgins are restricted to being used a trade language, and not all the trade language are also a pidgin. For example, there is English and Spanish are widely used as a trade language in many parts of Asia, Africa, but these languages are not pidgins. For small vocabulary, because pidgin developed to serve a very narrow language function, it is very restricted to have a simplified structure and small vocabulary compared with the fully developed language. And also, for example, Pacific Pidgin language that is used on Papua New Guinea have only 5 vowels. For example, A, E, I, O, N, U, compared to around 20 in most varieties of English. For attitude, pidgin language do not have high status or prestige because the large number of pidgin words which derive from European language in pidgin, such as Tupisin, the English-based pidgin spoken in Papua New Guinea, many Europeans consider pidgins to be the best form of their own language. They assume they can guess the meaning, but this can be led to misunderstanding, which has been a very serious problem. Okay. To sum up pidgin language, it has three identifying characteristics. It is used in restricted domain and function, which we know that it's used for trade and colonialism. And the second one, it has a simplified structure compared to the source language. And the third one, it generally has low prestige and attract negative attitudes, especially from the outsider, because it used mostly tied to colonialism and slavery. Next one is Creoles. Creoles is pidgins which has acquired native speaker are called Creole language. A language is Creole if it has been learned as a first language by a large number of speakers and has developed accordingly to meet their linguistic needs. As a result of their status and as some groups first language, Creole also differ from pidgins in their range of function. in their structure, and in some cases in the attitude expressed toward them. The next one is structural features. Pigeons become more structurally regular as they undergo creolization. Creolization is a process which pigeon language become creole. The linguistic complexity of creole language is often not appreciated by the outsider. As I mentioned above, the pigeon language do not use affix to signal meanings such as tense of a verb or number of noun. Creole language, however, do develop way of systematically signaling meanings such as verb, and this may develop into affliction or affix over time. For example, 11, we can see how the past tense and continuous aspect are expressed in Creole language. The past tense is signaled by the particle been, while the progressive aspect is marked by the suffix bed, which is attached to the verb. For example, 12, this is a pigeon stage reference to future events. Okay, so this is a took pigeon use the adverb by, which is derived from English phrase by and by. This is illustrated in sentence A by you go, as the pigeon develop into creole, the adverb gradually shortened to by or by as in B and C. And the sentence D illustrate the alternate position used for by, while in the E example shows how it eventually become attached to verb as a regular prefix signaling future tense. The meaning is expressed more consciously, but also less obviously a common outcome. For the table 4.2, this is a meaning relationship between the word in the first column and third column is exactly the same. Yes, and this is reflected in the form of the creole, but not in English. So this pattern is possible to form a new word in Creole language and to guess the English translation. As you can see, for exercise 7, as Creole develops, paraphrase like this become more compact and concise, and often at the cost of semantic transparency. This is Creole a number process in language. So what's meant is combination of element meaning men employed to do the washing, a bit like English in washerwoman. But though its meaning is clear when you know and therefore easy to remember, there is no reason why it could mean man was in the street when he stand, and have derived from long phrase spelling out that meaning more explicitly. Once it has compacted into what man is, precise meaning has to be learned. Similarly with diamond, could be mean executioner or hangman, but in fact it means corpse. When concise compound like this develop from longer phrases, they become less transparent, and this is common process in the process of language. For function, many present-day Creole are spoken in the descendant of the African slaves in the USA and Caribbean. The common language of the plantation was generally a pidgin, and children usually acquired the pidgin as a first language. In multilingual speech communities, parents may use pidgin so extensively during the day in the market, at church, in office, and on public transport that it become normal for them to use it at home too. For attitude toward Creoles are often negative, as their attitude to pigeons. Capacin, a status and prestige for people in Papua New Guinea who recognize its usefulness as a means of communication. Okay, for talk speaking is a language of solidarity between Papua New Guinea with different vernaculars. Origins and ending. Despite their geographical spread, they are found in every continent. Many similarities are found among the pigeon and creoles. Some have argued that all pigeon and creole had a common origin. But they claim the most pigeon can be tracked back to a single 5th century Portuguese pigeon and perhaps to further to Mediterranean lingua franca, Sabir. Others argue that each pigeon arise, develop independently. They account for the similarities by pointing to two examples of constraints on their development, which they all share. Firstly, pigeon arise in a different context, but for the same kind of basic function, trade, barter, or and other essential transaction oriented function. Okay, that's all from our group presentation. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.